Good morning. We're so glad to have you with us today. We're looking forward for our time of worship together this morning. Real quick, I have a few announcements to make you aware of. First of all, we are still doing Operation Christmas Child. And this month, the items are Hot Wheel cars, small stuffed animals, small dolls, and coloring books. Keep in mind that they have to fit inside with a bunch of other stuff inside a shoebox. And so if you do see some of those things or run across those things, you can start collecting those things for our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes that will go out in November. Also, do want to remind you that our service is on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. Just search First Church of God Oak Grove on YouTube, and it should come up if you want to watch or join us on our services through YouTube. Also, we do want to thank you for your faithful giving during our offering, for our offering time. If you do have an offering, you can either mail it to the office, you can call us and drop it off, or we can come pick it up, or you can give through your online banking. If you have any questions about that, just call the office and we'll talk with you about that. Also, one more thing, our Call 'Em All message service. Our phone number usually comes from the church, but it has changed. And it is now, there's an 800 number that'll show up. We're going to have that posted in our newsletter this next time. So be sure you look at that. You might want to add that to your caller ID so you'll recognize it as a call from the church. The good thing about that number, it is an 800 number, and you can call that number back and you can listen to the last message that was sent out to you. So if there's a problem or something with your message, it doesn't work right, just call that number back and you can listen to the latest message that was sent. If you're not on our Call 'Em All list and would like to be added or be added to our prayer team, our prayer chain ministry there, call us at the office and we'll make sure and get you added there. We're so glad to have you this morning. At this time, Brother Josh is going to come for our invocation and our call to worship.
Good morning. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for this day. God, we ask that as we gather around this community, that the words of our songs will be praiseworthy to your ear. God, we ask that you would open our hearts, our ears, our minds, as we hear from your word, as you speak through Brother Jonathan. Oh God, we give you this service for your glory, in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 89, verse 1. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known through all generations.
Jesus, Jesus, marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be.
I'd just like to thank my church family on behalf of my family. Y'all have been a blessing to us, and we thank you for the prayers and the loss of our dad. We love you, and just keep the prayers coming. Just continue to worship now. James 1:12 says, blessed is a man who endures trials, because he will receive the crown of life. Thank you.
As we go before the Lord in prayer together this morning, there are several requests they need to make known to you. Do remember Miss Brenda Dozier. She fell a little over a week ago, and just remember her. Also, Jesse Henderson had brain surgery recently. Remember Jesse. Also, Mr. Jim Pischoff was transferred back home. They have him at home on hospice, and so we ask for your prayers on his behalf and on behalf of his family as well. Also remember those who have lost loved ones, the Larry Harrison family, the Jack Mills family, and the Bob Schaefer family. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come before you today, and we lift up our requests to you, recognizing our great need. Lord, we think about our nation and the situation we find ourselves in as a result of this pandemic, Lord, and we just ask that you would be with each one in their individual situation, Lord. We pray for those who are sick, those who are in the hospital, and we lift each one to you, knowing that you are able to meet the need. And so, Lord, in this time of great difficulty, we pray that we would turn our hearts and our minds to you. Lord, we think about the prayer needs that have been mentioned, those that are on our list this morning, Lord. I think about Mr. Jim Pischoff as he is home. I know that that's where he wants to be. But we just ask that you would continue to be with him and give strength, and that you would lift him up and be with his family as well during this time. As we know, he's in a lot of pain, and this is a difficult time for him. Lord, we think about those who have lost loved ones. We ask that you would be with each one during this time. These are unprecedented times, and the inability to come around and to give them a hug and lift them up. And we just ask that you would especially give strength and your comfort. And they would know that even though we can't do everything that we would normally do to express our love and concern, that they would feel and know that you are with them and that you will lift them up. Well, this morning, as we continue in our time together, as we open your word, we ask that you would have your way this morning, that you would be honored and glorified in all that is said and done. Lord, we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. I do want to mention this morning that there are updated prayer lists on our website, ogfcog.com, as well as on our Facebook page, and we encourage you to go there and get one of those prayer lists and make it a part of your daily prayer time as we lift one another up in prayer during these times. We do want to welcome you to our service this morning. We're glad that you've joined us and chosen to spend some time together in worship today, and as we spend some time in the Word of God. If you were here last Sunday, you might remember that we started a series that we're calling Home Improvement. With our inability to gather in person as the body of Christ here in this place, the importance of the home in our life of faith has become even more evident. Last week, we looked at Joshua's call for the people to follow his example and commit themselves and commit their households to the Lord. And I pray that as a family like Joshua, you can say, as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. If you have your Bible nearby, you can turn with me this morning to the New Testament book of Ephesians. We'll be in chapter 5, and we're going to be starting in verse 8 today. Here in chapter 5, the Apostle Paul calls the church to live as imitators of God. When others look at your life, let them see God in you. That's what Paul is saying. That they should see God in us and through us by the way that we love, as Christ loved when he gave himself as a sacrifice for us. Jesus, in his death, showed the depth of his love for us. He loved us so much that he was willing to die and to rescue us, to save us from our sin. I'm not going to spend a lot of time this morning. I'm not going to read all of chapter 5. But I do encourage you to take some time, either today, maybe later today, or sometime this week, and spend some time in Ephesians. Read chapter 4, 5, and 6. It's not real long. But I encourage you to read those chapters as Paul describes what it looks like to live a life that has been transformed by the Lord. To live a life worthy of the calling that we have received. You see, I believe if everyone who claims the name of Jesus, claims to be his disciple, a follower of him, if we would all put these words of Paul into practice in our lives, this world would be a much better place, and his light would shine more brightly in this world, and people would be drawn to our Savior. Starting in the last part of verse 14, Paul writes this in chapter 5. Wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to the God, the Father, for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Here in these verses, we see the call of the believer. You know, we're going to spend some time in just a few minutes looking at how we should relate to one another in our families and as husbands, as wives, and children and parents. But how we live in these relationships is rooted in how we live as believers. You can't separate the two. Our life as a believer will have an impact on our life as a husband or a wife or a child or a parent. Paul was calling the people to wake up. Wake up out of your slumber. Wake up out of your complacency. Wake up out of your selfishness and foolishness, because the days are evil. And in many ways, you haven't even noticed. You've been caught up in worldly thinking. You've adopted worldly wisdom, worldly values, and in so doing, the light of Christ hasn't been shining in you. This week, during our Wednesday night time together, we talked about the importance of shining as a light. And we used the illustration of a flashlight. The darker it is, the more difference the light makes. But what happens when those who should live as light don't shine? It's like having a flashlight in the dark, but never turning it on. Those in darkness don't see. They remain lost and hopeless in their darkness. What does it look like to wake up from our slumber? What does it look like to rise from the dead? Paul says we need to be careful how we live, because how we live is important. Not because by doing good things we somehow earn our salvation or make ourselves more worthy of the gift of God, but instead because our transformed lives shine. They shine for the world to see. We're called to make the most of every opportunity to make him known, because the days are evil. There are people all around us who need to know his truth, and they will never know it unless they see a Christian, someone that they know, someone that they respect, that they see them shining for the Lord. They need to see it lived out in us, in his people, in his church. I choose to live in his light, not just for myself, but for others. I choose to do good, not just for myself, but for others. I choose to serve, not for myself, but for the benefit of others. See, the Christian life is not a life that is focused on self, but on the Lord and on others. That's why when Jesus was asked about the most important commandment, do you remember what he said? He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. God, love God, and love others. We're to be outward thinking as we are concerned about the situation and the hearts and the minds and souls of others. We're called to be a people, Paul says, who give thanks for everything. You know, that's not always easy, especially in times like these. It's easy to get down, easy to become discouraged, to forget how much we have to be thankful for. I find it kind of strange when I go to the store, wondering if they'll have paper towels or if they'll have the things that I need, or if they'll have hamburger. I'll go to the store and we're going to make spaghetti, and I go to the store to see if they have hamburger so we can make spaghetti, and then find that when I get there, the shelf is empty and there's nothing available. You know, it could be easy in times like that, in situations like that, to get frustrated, to get even discouraged, to get mad at those who are buying more than they need. I can't get what I need. I could get frustrated, or I could choose to be thankful. Thankful that I don't have to worry about finding something to feed my family, because there's, even though they don't have exactly what I came for or exactly what I was looking for, there's still lots of food to be had. It might not be what I was planning on. It may not be what I was expecting. But there's food, and I can feed my family. We can be thankful. Always giving thanks to God for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, as believers, we're called to submit, Paul says, to one another out of reverence for Christ. This is the way that we're called to relate to one another. You know, it's not always the easiest of things to do. To submit means to make myself vulnerable to someone else. And that can be a difficult thing. How do we live in submission to one another? Well, as Paul continues in this scripture, he gives several examples of what this looks like in the life of a believer. What does it look like in your relationships as you learn to submit to one another as Christ did to the Father? This morning we're going to focus on just three of these examples and how this idea of living in submission to one another is lived out in our families, between wives and husbands and children and parents. Paul, as he continues in chapter 5, begins with his instructions for wives. In verses 22 through 24, he says this: wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Okay, we're wading into dangerous waters. I want you to know that these are Paul's words, they're not mine, but they were inspired by Almighty God. Our culture today is resistant to the idea of submission to one another. Doesn't matter who it is. We don't want to submit to anyone. And as a man, it's especially inappropriate to say that a woman should submit to anyone. How dare you? What gives you the right? But the scripture here is clear. We need to remember that Paul here is describing a relationship between believers. Two people, a man and a woman, who love the Lord. And though he starts with instructions for wives, you can't look at these words alone. A wife can freely submit to her husband because it's safe to do so. There is no fear. She isn't oppressed, but instead it's a free expression of the fullness of what God intended a relationship between a husband and a wife to be. It's a relationship that's modeled after the relationship of Jesus and His church. As the church, we freely submit to Jesus because of His great love for us, because of His sacrifice on our behalf. It's not an obligation. It's not something that we're forced to do, but it's something that we are called to do freely because of His love for us. It's a privilege. And the same is true for a wife. She should be able to experience the freedom of submission because her husband also takes Paul's words to heart. To submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. He lives it out in his own life and makes it possible for his wife also to freely submit herself to him. Do you want to experience the fullness of what God intended marriage to be? Choose to freely submit to your husband. Choose to freely submit and encourage him to be the man that God created him to be. But Paul's words didn't end with wives. He goes on with his instructions for husbands. In verses 25 through 33, husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Husbands, did you get all that? I want you to notice that the instructions to wives only included 3 verses. But when it comes to husbands, it was more like 8. A lot more instruction here when it comes to husbands. Probably because we're pretty hard-headed at times. And sometimes we have trouble following directions. And so he wanted to be sure that we understood what the call on our life is when it comes to the relationship with our wives. He wanted to be sure that we get this thing right. As husbands, we're called to love our wives just as Christ loved the church. How did he love the church? He loved us so much that he offered his life and his service and in sacrifice for us. Husbands, do you want to experience the fullness of what God has intended for your marriage to be? Love your wife as Christ loved the church. Give of yourself sacrificially. Serve. Make your marriage a place of safety and security where she is safe to submit herself freely without fear. You see, this marriage relationship is really about mutual submission to one another. Always having each other's best interests at heart as you seek to build each other up. Relationship experts say that the 4 biggest killers of marriages are criticism, defensiveness, stonewalling, and contempt. If you see these things creeping into your marriage, you need to take notice. Because they're not healthy. And if they're not dealt with, they can lead to major problems. What causes us to act toward each other with criticism, defensiveness, stonewalling, and contempt? a failure to love as Jesus loved, a failure to submit to one another. The safety of being real with each other is gone, and the bitterness begins to take root in our heart and in our mind. What do you do if you find yourself in a marriage that is struggling? A marriage where these things, criticism, defensiveness, stonewalling, and contempt are taking root? You have to make a choice. How are you going to respond? Are you going to allow those things to continue to grow? Are you going to dwell in those things? Or will you make a choice and put Paul's words into action? Don't wait for your partner to change. Begin to love. Begin to submit. And give them the space and the freedom to do the same. Husbands, love your wives as you love yourself. And wives, respect your husband. Show him that respect. Make him feel that he is respected. This is the foundation of a good and healthy marriage. Lastly, we see Paul's instructions for children and for parents. In verses 1 through 4 of chapter 6, he goes on, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with the promise that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." We know this command, don't we? Children, obey your parents, the fifth commandment. Honor your father and your mother. You see, the Lord has placed parents in the lives of their children to serve as guides, to direct them in the way that they should go, to teach them the ways of the Lord, to teach them to serve Him and to walk with Him. A good and healthy relationship with your parents will be a blessing to you all the days of your life. If you have godly parents, if you have parents who love you and care about you, you have parents that taught you and are teaching you the right way to live, treasure that relationship. Choose to honor them with obedience. Notice here that obedience is simply a form of submission. As we submit ourselves to our parents. Just as husbands and wives are called to submit to one another, children are called to submit themselves to their parents' leadership, to their parents' authority. But parents also have a responsibility to their children. Paul says, don't exasperate your children. Don't frustrate them. Don't expect more of them than they can give. Don't cause them to become discouraged and downhearted. Parents, we have a responsibility to engage in a meaningful relationship with our children. One that is positive and builds up and guides and protects. Everyone is called to give of themselves to one another, to submit themselves to one another as they make that commitment. Children to parents and parents to children. And when we do, our relationships can grow healthy and strong. And God is honored in our homes. Do you seek to have a home where God is honored? To live in a home where God is lifted up, where his light shines? When others look at your life, when others look at your family, do they see a family that honors God? Do they see His light shining through you? As we close this morning, I would just encourage you to choose to live in submission to God, in submission to Him, and in submission to one another. Put Paul's words into action and watch your relationships grow strong and healthy. Do everything within your power to provide room for your relationships within the church, with your spouse, with your children and parents, to grow strong and to be pleasing to the Lord. And put Paul's words into practice as you submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you this morning, thanking you for your word, thanking you for your instruction, thank you for reminding us what it means to live in relationship with one another. Lord, that we wouldn't expect more than we're willing to give, but Lord, that we would give of ourselves fully, and as a result, that would be returned to us. That our relationships would grow, that they would blossom, that they would become something that we treasure, something that we take great delight in, because we put your words into practice in our life. As we've submitted to one another. Or we recognize this is true in our relationship with one another, with other believers, with the relationships within our families, with our friends. And so, Lord, we ask that we would have the strength, that we would have the ability to live in submission to one another. As we give of ourselves and we receive the blessing of living for you. Lord, we pray this morning that as families, as believers, that we would live as light in this dark world. That as others look at our lives, as they look at how we live, Lord, that they would see you shining in us. Lord, this morning I pray that we would choose to live like that. That we would choose to live for you. And that as we do, your Spirit would come alongside. That you would fill us up. That you would guide and direct. And that our lives would be lived in you. Lord, we offer this time to you. We pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. We're so glad that you joined us this morning. I would encourage you to live in submission to one another. This morning, if you've never accepted Christ, if you don't know Him, I encourage you to make that decision, the greatest decision you'll ever make in your life. Spend some time in prayer. Ask Him to forgive your sins. Confess your sinfulness before Him. And receive His gift of salvation. It's not hard. All it takes is a heart that is willing. A heart that seeks after Him and is willing to receive all that He has to give. If you make that decision today, we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to talk with you and pray with you. I encourage you to find a church. Find some place that you can worship together, that you can come alongside and walk with one another. As we live as the church in this world, and as His light shines through us in this dark world. We thank you once again for joining us today, and we hope that you have a wonderful week. We encourage you to come back and join with us on Wednesday evenings at 6:30. Also, our Sunday school time on Sundays at 9:30, and our morning worship at 10:30. And then our youth devotionals on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, all at 5:00. We're so glad to have you today, and I pray that you have a wonderful week.